an advantage to the biodynamic farming method, where we use a lot of compost, cover crops, crop rotations and such, is that the ground gets cultivated, but not by me. Look at this ground, how it's all looks like someone's been in there cultivating. This has all been worked over by earthworms. These are earthworm castings that then crush and crumble and give the soil the best tilth that it could possibly have. And also, it hasn't rained in probably 3 or 4 weeks, and you can scrape that topsoil down and look at all that moisture. Yeah, the earthworms really know how to make and maintain good soil. Again, the good soil helps them to propagate their species. That's what life wants to do. These lowly creatures are of the greatest value for the earth. In an acre of soil, there can be 50,000 earthworms, and 10 tons of earth passes through an earthworm every year. This really makes good soils. Gardeners do everything they can to encourage earthworm activity. You can see the slickness on the earthworm. The slime that's on the outside of the earthworm coats their tunnels that go into the soil. And those tunnels can go several feet down. And when they collapse, that action is not dissimilar to what we do when we plow, but it's a lot more gentle. Earthworms are the best soil tillers. And they don't have much of a sense of smell, but they get by in the world through their sense of touch. Charles Darwin was a scientist in the 19th century who studied earthworms for many, many decades, and finally wrote a book published in 1881 about earthworms and the formation of vegetable mold through the action of earthworms with observations on their habits. He noticed in his garden that earthworms lived under the rocks and brought up fine soil, which then caused the rock to sink down a little bit every year, about a fifth of an inch per year. And it's this activity that happens in the digestion of system of the earthworm where they have a gizzard. And in the gizzard, there's lime and silica, the oxides of calcium and silicon, that then neutralize these humic and carbonic acids that help to break down the minerals in the soil, so it puts them in a colloidal state so they're available for plant growth, but don't leach out when it rains. Well, you can see that slime on there. I mean, that's the greatest stuff for your garden. And then you get all these little tunnels. And these tunnels then have that little bit of slime on them. And that's what really breaks up this clay and turns it into humus. And we get these good soils and we add our compost and leaves and various things of this nature, organic matter, onto the soil. Of course, they'd like a limey soil too, so we want to have lime in the ground. And you can tell a lot about your soils. Now, when I see earthworms that are small and skinny and pink, I know the soil's not very good. I like earthworms that have a lot of these colors in them and this shine to them. It tells me I got good soil. Earthworm eggs are omnipresent, probably through the activity of birds. So we don't have to add worms to our soil particularly. What we need to do is add organic matter, compost, chopped up leaves, old hay, rotten wood products. Even a piece of cardboard laid down on the ground becomes earthworm food, and in a matter of, you know, a rain or two on it, and you'll lift it up and see earthworms underneath it. They're truly the greatest boon for the organic gardener. And so when I think of my favorite animal, my mind goes from the lofty eagles down to the lowly, wonderful golden creatures of the soil, the common red wiggler earthworm.
Now that I've shared with you all the beneficial results of earthworm activity, I'd like to share with you some of the negative effects of one particular species called the Asian jumping worm. Now, when I first saw these in my compost pile, I thought I was growing these great worms that had all this energy. But a little research proved that they're actually not good for the ground. They seem to eat just the litter on the surface, but don't make the earthworm castings that we find so beneficial in gardening. Here to help us understand more about this Asian jumping worm is Medulla Grish from the University of Tennessee. It's so nice to see you.
Nice
Thank
to
you
meet
for coming.
You. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, so describe a little bit about what these worms look like. I know that they wriggle a lot.
Right. So they can go up to 6 to 8 inches in length here, and they are mostly darkly pigmented, and they have like a metallic sheen, and they have a clitellum that is like very peculiar about them. It is like a milky white color.
The thing that goes around.
Yeah,
the white band.
Yeah. So yeah, it covers the entire body as like
not just the top.
Right. So in as their European counterparts, like you know, it's kind of a raised and it's like pinkish clitellum.
Okay.
But this covers the entire body, and like yeah, as the name suggests, like as you were mentioning, they are very active, and they act vigorously when they are disturbed, and you can see them thrashing. They produce cocoons.
Yes, like
so,
regular worms.
Right. And these are like darkly colored again, and like dirt color, like which is
hard
very difficult
to find.
Exactly, which is difficult to figure out, right? And so when the temperature warms up in spring, like let's say when it hits like 50 degrees Fahrenheit, mm-hmm. is when the cocoon starts hatching, and it takes a while to attain maturity, like 90 to 120 days probably.
3 or 4 months.
So yeah. And that is their life cycle. It's mostly annual.
But then they make more cocoons for
right. So yeah, then this continues, and then the cocoons again overwinter, and like they just like they just survive the harsh winter, and
yeah.
again the next spring season, it's repeated. Yeah.
So where are people finding these?
So it can be anywhere, unfortunately. It can be in your urban parks. It can be like in your suburban yards.
Yeah.
It can be like in your compost piles, like along the road. So it's pretty much everywhere, yeah.
Yeah, and so this is not good for our soils then.
Yeah, so what happens, it's feed on the most critical layer of the organic matter, the leaf litters and everything.
Top.
Yeah, so, and as compared to the European or the night crawlers that is like common. So what happens, they reproduce like very fast. So it's quick and you know, and their feeding is really quick. So
uh-huh.
imagine it's like eating like a more faster rate, like it's depleting all the organic matter,
right.
like really
so
fast.
Instead of turning back into soil,
yeah.
it just makes more of these worms.
Right, so and their castings are mostly like ground coffee grains and yeah.
That's what, so the castings look like ground coffee.
Yeah,
grains.
It's like dry and like yeah. It's
not that moist.
Right, it's not moist,
stuff.
Yeah. It's like a dry and like yeah.
Wow. And so how are we going to control these?
So, unfortunately, we do not have like it's all eradication is something that we can do from our part, like just like stop spreading Asian jumping worms.
And how are they spread?
Right. So, it's mainly spread through human activity. Like, you know, probably when we go for hiking and we come back with the cocoons
and
we're not, yeah, we're not very aware of it. So make sure that you brush off your boots or hiking boots when you come back. And also make sure that the compost, if you are locally sourcing the compost, make sure that it is properly polarized, solarized
yeah.
in, and like so that it kills the cocoons.
What's the temperature range for these Asian jumping worms in the soil?
So for the solarization, it's advocated that like around 104 to 140-ish. Yeah,
that will kill them.
Right. So if it's in the, if the, you know, if it is in the sun for that long, for consistently for 3 days or so, that is going to take care of the Asian jumping worms. Yeah, and I mean the cocoons.
Right, that'll take care of the cocoons. Yeah.
And if you put some soap or something on the ground, can we bring them to the surface to gather them?
Correct. So if you have like a Asian jumping worm issue in your lawn or yard, like you can either use a tea tree meal so that it has saponin, and that kind of like you can just pour. And this is not going to kill the worms, but it will just like make them come to the surface. So you can just see
them. You can take them and kill
them. And handpick. Or also you can pour some mustard. Like if you can use some mustard, ground mustard and
ground mustard.
Yeah, and probably make it like a add 1 gallon water and probably make a mix of it, and you can just like pour slowly, and that also kind of irritates them, and you can see them thrashing. If you see a worm, it's like just put them in a bag, a clear plastic container, and seal them, and probably you can leave them directly under sunlight for a few hours, and then probably it goes to the trash.
So the best thing is just to get it in a bag and then either put it out in the sun or put it in a freezer or something like that, that'll kill it.
Yeah, you can put them in the freezer too. Like, yeah, leave it like for a few hours and then probably trash them, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Well, if people find them, should they let UT know about it?
Yeah, you can contact your local extension agent and probably you can
just
report
to
them.
Know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it seems like a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Wow. And do they foresee this being a big problem in horticulture?
So, I mean, yeah, they are there. Unfortunately, we cannot prevent that spread because, like, they are widespread. Approximately 34 states already have the
34 states already. Mm-hmm.
That's so far that I know have already Asian jumping worm infestation. So, once this is a problem with invasive species, right?
Like, invasive species can be a problem. That's, how long have they been around here?
So it's dated back in 1800s.
Oh, really?
Right? Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So they've been around for a long time.
Right, right.
But just not very many of them.
Yeah, it's getting slowly spread.
Slowly spread. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, if we have pots that we've got nursery stock from and we want to use them again, how would we sterilize them?
Dispose everything, the soil, and make sure if you're reusing the pot, clean them really well and probably dip them in 10% beet solution and sterilize them really well, and then probably that should be fine.
Yeah. And just for the backyard gardeners, how's it going to affect us? I mean,
right. So it's going to, as I mentioned before, it's going to feed on the critical layer of the organic matter, the leaf litters, and so it kind of depletes the nutrients, and that will also affect the native plants to grow up, right? Like they are deprived of the essential nutrients that they need to survive. So,
Well, we got to have organic matter to grow stuff. Well, thank you so much for sharing.
Right, thank you.
For inspiring garden tours, growing tips, and garden projects, visit our website at volunteergardener.org or on YouTube at the Volunteer Gardener channel, and like us on Facebook.